Good morning and welcome to the International Space Station Flight Control Room, where, as I promised, we're talking with Dr. Jean Sibonga, who is the bone lead for the Human Research Program. So that's an interesting title, bone lead.
Yeah, essentially what that means is I am the point of contact for every question that comes up in bone, whether it comes from engineering or whether it comes from fellow scientists or from medical operations.
Wow. I know that bones are one of the things we're really looking at pretty hard since that spaceflight's been shown to affect bones for astronauts, right?
Yes. In fact, we've been studying it for as long as we've been having human spaceflight.
And so what have we been seeing?
Well, over the past 10, 15 years, we've been applying a clinical diagnostic test for evaluating osteoporosis in our astronauts. And some of that data has revealed that we have some very unique changes in our astronauts up in space.
Uh-huh. Such as?
Well, they have a very accelerated rate of bone loss, and the bone loss is not general across the skeleton, but it's actually at specific sites. You know, it's the weight-bearing sites that we have here on Earth. You know, it's the lower half of our body versus the upper body. It's our hips. It's our spine.
Things that they don't use so much when they're not in gravity.
No, actually, it's the opposite.
Okay.
They use it a lot in gravity so that when they go up into space and there's this big differential, there's this big deficit of having the bones to be strong, and so they seem to adapt more and lose more mass.
Okay, well, I know, you know, we see commercials about drink more milk and things like that, but why is bone density important to begin with?
Well, I know if you were to see some of the data that kind of outlines bone loss and bone gain as humans, you know, grow up and certainly age over time, you'll see that we have our peak bone mass around the age of 30 and 35, and then after that is kind of downhill all the way. It's a very slow process, and so when we think about osteoporosis, when we look at, you know, the elderly people with their dowager's humps or, you know, with these fractures from very little trauma, you know, this is because of the condition of bone that it's deteriorated over time, and so, you know, it's not exactly a geriatric disease, but it's actually a geriatric consequence or a manifestation because of all of the risk factors that people are exposed to through life. And so we want to understand if the exposure of astronauts to prolonged periods up in space somehow contributes to osteoporosis as well.
And so what are you finding so far?
Well, we're finding with this very rapid loss that this has a concern because it seems to be the magnitude or the range of losses seems to kind of mimic or model what we see in postmenopausal women, which is actually a big concern for the clinical field here. However, we also have a lot of research data that reveals some interesting things about these changes in space. One is that there are actually changes in bone structure, and that helps us to understand exactly how does exercise or how do any of these pharmacological agents that we're using as countermeasures, you know, how does this really impact the structure of bone as well as their bone mineral density?
Well, so speaking of countermeasures, I know that's one of the big things we're looking at is how we actually combat that bone density loss. So what are some of the things we're doing now?
Well, for one thing, you know, being up in space is, you know, there are a lot of our constraints. We can't always give the best diet we possibly can. We do as best as we can. There's some issues with not having a lot of shielding, and so we don't have the ultraviolet light that helps us convert vitamin D, for example.
Sorry, say that again, ultraviolet light?
Ultraviolet, or the sunshine. You know, when we go out into sunshine and it helps us to convert or metabolize vitamin D in our body, so that helps us to absorb calcium. You know, we have all that shielding up in space on the space station, so that has an impact as well. And then just to be able to do exercise, you know, we are here in a one gravity environment here on Earth, and 24/7 we're exposed to that gravity. But up there, you know, the only kind of loading that they experience on the bone is maybe that those 2 hours or less than 2 hours that we have from doing exercises.
And so what does exercise do that helps?
Well, you know, when it keeps up prevents kind of the muscles from atrophying up in space. You know, we like to maintain those muscle forces on our bones. So essentially, you know, excuse me, if our bones don't have to work as hard as they do here on the Earth because, you know, it's so easy to move in weightlessness or you know, they don't have that gravitational force upon us, then, you know, Bone's pretty smart, and they'll say, well, you know, I don't need to be as strong as I usually am on Earth, and so it's going to be very efficient and start to drop some of its mass. And that's what we're seeing with the breakdown of Bone up in space.
Okay, so efficiency, that's an interesting way to put it. I hadn't thought of it like that. So same thing we see when we don't use our muscles, I guess, in space and on Earth, we start to lose them. Same thing happens with bones.
That's it, exactly. It's a form of bone atrophy.
Okay. And so one of the ways we work out our bones is the exercise. But I know there are other things y'all are doing for countermeasures.
That's right. I mean, we want to exercise, kind of give a reason for our bones to be strong. But in addition, you know, that might not be enough because, as I said, exercise is only about 2 hours a day or so, okay, or even less than that. And then we also want to be able to, you know, be able to provide supplementation of vitamin D because of the issues of not having the sunlight to, as we do here on Earth. And then there are also kind of therapeutic drugs that we use here on Earth to combat metabolic bone diseases that are very similar to the breakdown that we see up in space in our astronauts. So the agents that we use to prevent bone loss in postmenopausal women are being tested up there in space.
Okay, so vitamin D, is that something, for instance, or the other medicines, do all of the astronauts use them all the time, or do some of them use it, or how does that work?
Well, essentially, it's a requirement. So we are providing supplementation to them, and we do monitor that supplementation to make sure that they have the, you know, the requirements to be able to you know, maintain that level.
Okay, and what are some of the results you're seeing so far?
Well, you know, we don't have directly those results. I mean, this is a requirement, so we do want to kind of monitor that all the time. As far as the effects on the bone mineral density as a result of the bisphosphonates, they're very encouraging. Also, the effects of our new exercise device that's up there is very encouraging. In fact, recently we had a bone summit of a clinical panel, advisory panel of some of the leaders in the bone field, and they had a chance to review our medical and our research data, and they also came out with that finding that it's encouraging data, but the jury's still out on this still.
Okay, well, that's good news. And what about, you know, when the astronauts get back to Earth and they start using their bones like normal again, does it start to correct itself, or is it something you have to keep doing, I don't know, special exercises or taking more vitamin D and other medicines?
Well, you know, that's a very interesting thing that you bring up because this is something that's dear to my heart. Essentially, you know, we know that there are changes in bone structure. We know that there are changes in bone mineral density. But, you know, the technology that we use now, which is the clinically accepted technology for diagnosing, you know, osteoporosis in little old people or in postmenopausal women, it's not quite, and it has some limitations when we apply it to our astronauts because our astronauts are, you know, they're healthy and they're robust and they go through a very novel change. You know, not everybody here on Earth is exposed to a weightless environment. And so there's actually a requirement to look at, to collect more data as to how those changes, what those changes are in bone. And so we have a flight study that's coming up to actually to do a monitoring or surveillance of these changes in bone structure. And from those data, which come off of the quantitative computed tomography, which is a new, it's an X-ray-based imaging device. So when we take those data and we analyze it with this computational tool called finite element modeling, it helps us to estimate the strength of the bones, particularly of the hip. And with that knowledge, we know what are the loads that are going to cause that bone to fracture. We could use that to kind of direct their rehabilitation program. You know, how successful is their countermeasure up in space, or how successful is their rehab program after return to Earth, so that we could possibly avoid the risk for a post-mission fracture.
Interesting. Wow. Well, so now what about the kind of the other side of it? Are the things that we're doing and finding out about bones with the astronauts, is that helpful to people who are stuck here on Earth?
Yes, you know, there is a population of folks that who are immobilized and are at risk for fractures. You know, like the spinal cord injury population is one. We're always looking for new ways of evaluating bone as a predictor for fractures. And so the technologies that we're applying, the modeling techniques, these are, you know, state-of-the-art kind of analyses. And if we could apply, you know, get those developed and validated and apply it to our patient population, you know, the this is going to be a great boon to the clinical field.
Excellent. That's always good news. Thank you so much for coming and talking with us. We really appreciate it.
Oh, it was my pleasure.
This again was Dr. Jean Sibonga, who is with the Human Research Program, the bone lead for that program. So we'll go back now to our regular ISS update. Thanks.